When an antenna looks into the world, it encounters signals and noise from every direction, making it hard to isolate the one you want. A solution would be to use a parabolic antenna, which helps by focusing the beam in a single direction, allowing us to target a specific point in space. In radar, we use this to transmit a signal, wait for it to reflect off our desired target, and return. But physically rotating the antenna to look at other targets can be slow and lacks flexibility. So how do we solve this? One way is with a phased array. But what is a phased array? Well, it's kind of all in the name. Instead of using a single antenna that we have to manually move around to look at different things in our scene, we use an array of multiple antennas, each with their own controllable phase. And if you're unfamiliar, the phase is just the delay between the signals we're transmitting or receiving relative to one another. So here I'm changing each of the elements' phases, which will be useful later. And this is a huge shift with some awesome upsides, but also some downsides. This video will be separated into two sections, steering and the antenna pattern. And there's chapters to skip between the two if you want. In the first section, I'll show how and why we would steer an antenna array. And in the second section, we'll learn how to calculate this beam shape for both one-dimensional and two-dimensional arrays. And this will help us lay the foundation for understanding how you can modify the shape to fit your needs. Let's start with how to steer a phased array. We'll start with two elements because that's enough to illustrate the concept, but this number could be anything from 4 to tens of thousands of elements depending on the application. Like I said before, there's signals and noise in all directions, so let's pick out one of these signal sources and see what happens when it hits our antennas. Previously, I showed these signals coming in as simple sine functions, but they're really waves traveling through the air. And if you think about a wave coming out of a single point source, it would look like just a bunch of circles or spheres in 3D. So as this circle travels further and gets larger, if we were to look at one section of it, that section will more and more closely resemble a flat line, or again in the case of a sphere, a flat plane. When it gets to a point that is sufficiently flat, it's called a plane wave. Now, the boundary between still being a spherical wavefront and being a plane wave, otherwise known as the boundary between the near and far fields, isn't perfectly defined, but a common generalization is 2 times the largest antenna dimension, which, for example, if you had a 2-foot by 3-foot antenna, the largest dimension would be 3 feet, and you put that squared over the wavelength. This is super important for phased arrays because if a signal can be approximated as a plane wave when it hits our antenna, the analysis becomes much easier, so I'll focus on the far field region for this video. So, say a plane wave is coming head-on to the antennas. Since the wave is pretty much flat, it'll hit these two antenna elements at the same time. Then, when it goes into the antennas and through some amplification, filtering, and whatever other components, we can combine the two signals. In this case, the sine waves came in at the same time and will therefore be in phase with one another. So adding them will be 100% constructive rather than destructive and will increase the amplitude. Okay, so what if we made this more interesting and had a wave coming in at an angle? In this case, the wave would hit the right antenna first, and then after some time hit the left antenna. We then send it through that same circuitry of amplification and filtering and get back to the combining stage. We still have two signals, but now the left signal has been delayed some since it hit the antenna after the right. For a single frequency, this will lead to a phase shift between the two signals, and combining them would have some amount of destructive and constructive interference, giving an output like this where the amplitude is smaller. And this change could change even more depending on the phase shift or time delay. So let's add another component before the combining stage called a phase shifter. Using this, we can artificially add a phase shift to both of these signals. If beforehand we knew the phase shift between the signals coming in from the antennas, we could add the opposite of that to the left phase shifter and get the signals back in phase. So then, when we hit the combining stage again, we're back to 100% constructive combining, and we again get a larger amplitude. Let's now go back to that phase shift value and take another look at the wave coming head-on. Like before, the signals come into the antennas in phase, then go through the amplifier and filter, but now the left signal then gets this artificial phase shift, and by the time they get to the combining stage, they're no longer in phase, leading to a smaller amplitude than before. So, if you think about it, we've effectively steered our antenna array to point in the direction of the wave coming in from the right. And that was without having to move any components physically. These phase shifters can then be updated within microseconds or less, which is much faster than a mechanical positioner can handle, so we now have an incredibly quickly scanning antenna. Pretty awesome, right? So, we found that this magical delta phi number right here allows us to scan to an area in space, but how do we actually compute that? To do this, let's focus on the geometry. If we draw a line from the left antenna to the wavefront and call it distance L, this will be the extra distance the wave has to travel after hitting the first antenna. And let's add an axis here to make this simpler. Notice that if this is the z-axis, then the wavefront makes an angle theta with it. Unfortunately, we don't know either of these lengths that we could use with theta to compute L. But if we look at this right triangle here, we do know the bottom side length to be our antenna spacing dx. For this triangle, the adjacent side of this angle, which we'll call psi, would be L, the thing we're looking for. And since cosine of an angle is the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, cosine of psi would be equal to L over dx. We can even simplify this further because this angle made up of theta and psi is a right angle, and cosine of 90 degrees minus an angle is equal to sine of that angle. So substituting that in gives us sine theta is equal to L over dx. And if we arrange for L, this tells us the extra path length the wavefront must travel to reach the left antenna. We still want to convert this path length into a phase shift, so to do that, we can relate it to the wavelength lambda of the signal we care about, which is a function of frequency. The phase shift delta phi would be equal to L over the wavelength, which would give us the percentage of the wavelength that L covers, and then we can multiply that by 2 pi to get it in terms of radians. You can then plug in dx sine theta for L to get the full equation. So this means that if we know the antenna spacing dx, which you will because it's set when building the array, the wavelength lambda, which is just a function of your frequency, C over F, and the angle you want to steer to, theta, we can directly calculate the required phase shift for steering the beam. And that's how phased arrays use phase shifters to steer beams toward a desired angle. So that's the basic concept, and you can even apply this to any number of elements where the phase shifts would be 0, delta phi, 2 delta phi, 3 delta phi, and so on indefinitely. Pretty cool, right? Now, that was a lot of numbers, which can get confusing pretty quick, so to get a better feel, check out the Python notebook below where you can plug in numbers and try out all these equations yourself. But, I hear you ask, if this works with just two elements, why would we want to complicate it by adding more? Well, when we're scanning to a point, we're not just scanning to an exact point in space like this. What we actually transmit and receive with the antenna is much less ideal. So some of the radiated power, hopefully most, called the main lobe, goes where we want, but the rest goes in all other directions and will look something like this. This is called the antenna pattern, which represents how our antenna transmits and receives energy in all directions. And it's actually comprised of two contributors. The element pattern, which is what each of these elements radiate individually, and the array factor, which accounts for how the combined pattern changes when multiple antenna elements are arranged together, including the effects of their relative phase and amplitude weights, which we'll talk more about later. Together, these two contributors determine the overall shape and directionality of the antenna pattern. Now, before I get into how this works, I want to mention that this is honestly an extremely complex topic, and my goal is not to give a comprehensive explanation. My goal is to give you an intuition for what is going on and the tools to go explore more for yourself. So, if you want to explore more on your own, the description includes some excellent books with page numbers, articles, and a Python notebook where you can play around with the concepts yourself. Now, there's a lot of ways to visualize how this is working, but I think the most intuitive explanation uses the Fourier transform, or some form of it. When most people think of the Fourier transform, it's probably most common to think about how you take samples of a signal, like a sine wave, and convert it into its frequency components. So this sine wave gets peaks on the frequency spectrum at plus and minus its frequency, and if we lowered the frequency to zero, that peak would head back to the zero point as well. But the magnitude would also approach zero, so if we add some offset, then we get this peak at zero because there's a signal, but one at zero frequency. By the way, this function right here is called the sinc function, or really the absolute value of it, which is equal to sine of x over x, and we'll see it later, so make note of that. Now, if we took samples along the amplitude plot, we would just get a bunch of ones. And if we were to go back to our antenna array, Isn't this also just a bunch of samples? But instead of samples separated by time, they're samples separated by space. Or, in other words, we're moving from temporal sampling to spatial sampling. So maybe we can model our phased array performance using the Fourier transform. Here I'll give a basic intro to how this transform works, but we'll need to go a little deeper later. The Fourier transform works by generating a reference wave for each frequency, using this complex form e to the negative j 2 pi ft, and multiplying with an input signal to get this. This multiplication causes some amount of constructive or destructive interference depending on how well the waves align, like we saw with the phase shifting earlier. And really, we'll be doing this math with samples rather than continuous signals, so let's add those real quick. The result of the multiplication of these two signals are then summed to produce a single value which represents the contribution at the frequency of the reference wave. So if we go back to a frequency of 0, we can scan through all the frequencies in the range of negative half the sampling rate to half the sampling rate, or negative pi to pi in normalized frequency terms, which would help us build a complete frequency spectrum from the input samples. When applied to antenna arrays, though, this same principle can compute the antenna's radiation pattern, treating the array's spatial structure like a sampled signal and analyzing how it radiates energy in different directions from negative pi to pi. By default, our in antennas can all be modeled by samples with values of 1. So let's start the scan back at 0 and change our input to all samples of 1. Applying the Fourier transform would produce what we saw previously, which is analogous to a signal with 0 frequency and some offset, or like a DC voltage. For this, you'd get a spike at theta equals 0 radians, and then the same sync pattern will continue to the extents of negative pi to pi. And normally we'll display this on a logarithmic scale, so we can talk about the pattern differences in decibels, which turns out to be a lot simpler. This still doesn't look quite like what we were expecting, though, where the pattern shows how the antenna radiates in all directions. So we can actually wrap this around in a circle to better show what it's doing. This section right here, called the main lobe, is where most of the power is being radiated. Its width is called the first null beam width because it's the space between these first two sections that drop down to near zero radiated power, called nulls. Then, as we go around, the radiated power gets lower, but not linearly. You get these bumps called side lobes that are a function of those samples of one we defaulted to, otherwise known as the array weights. A large part of designing an array is actually positioning these side lobes and nulls so that it doesn't affect your desired performance much. Because if you think about it, if you're trying to look at something that's right in front of you, but you have a side lobe here, not only will you receive some power from the desired location, but you'll also get some from the directions of all these other side lobes. In the case of a weather radar, this could give you a false sense of how bad the storm is in the desired location. Unfortunately, you can't completely remove these side lobes, but you can make it better. And that is the topic for the next video. But there's still more to talk about here because I know what you're all thinking. One-dimensional arrays are boring. We want to not just scan left and right, but up and down as well. Or, in other words, we want to be able to scan not just in theta, but also in phi. Okay, let's see how to do that. Since we just showed that computing the array factor is analogous to computing a signal's frequency spectrum, we'll start with the equation for the Fourier transform. Like we saw previously, this equation is split into two sections, our input signal, x of n, and the reference signal at a single swept frequency that helps us isolate the contributions of different frequencies in our signal. Adapting this to a phased array is simple for the x of n part. Basically, instead of inputting a time series signal like a sine wave, like we saw before, we're inputting the amplitudes of our phased array's spatial samples. Or, in other words, those ones I just talked about. Again, you can change these to change the pattern, but I'll keep them as ones for now, and we'll call this new input W of n, because it's the array amplitude weights. Okay, now this reference signal is where it actually gets interesting. If you're unfamiliar, this is the complex form of a sinusoid, which has a base form of e to the negative j theta t. Here, j is the imaginary root of negative 1, which won't change. T is the signal's time, and n is the discrete form of the time. And the one we can actually mess with is theta, which is the phase of the sinusoid. This theta tells us where in the complex plane we are. So say our theta, or in the case of the time series signal, 2 pi k over n, came out to be pi over 4, we would be right here. The time then sweeps this, and if we track the values over this time, we get a sinusoid. and that's how the reference signal is created. This concept is directly related to what's happening in the phased array. So if we go back to our array, remember earlier that we found if a plane wave is coming towards us at a non-zero angle, it will hit one element first, and then each consecutive one sometime after. We related this time delta to a distance delta, and then finally got the phase delta from that, which told us how to steer the array. That phase delta equation came out to the element spacing in the x direction, dx, times sine of the angle that the wave was coming in at, over the wavelength, all times 2 pi. So let's say that this delta phi is the phase difference between each of our spatial samples. Plugging that in for theta gives us this mess, but we can simplify it a bit. If we rearrange this, we can get a 2 pi over the wavelength, otherwise known as the wave number k, which tells us how many wave cycles fit into a unit of distance. Or you can also think of it as spatial frequency, just like how ordinary frequency describes cycles per unit time. Now, this isn't to be confused with the k from before, that is the discrete frequency of the time series signal. Pretty confusing notation, right? We still have this time term, which needs to be converted to spatial coordinates, though. Instead of traversing through the phase of the time series signal with this discrete time in, like before, we're now traversing through the phase of the antenna elements, so we can just put an index m here to account for all of the phase shifts. Going through the possible values of m would give us 0 phase shift, 1 times the phase shift, 2 times the phase shift, and so on. So there's the reference signal. Going back to the full equation, we can swap out the old time series reference signal with our phased array reference signal. But before we move on, we need to adjust for the variables we changed. Like, we were summing over the time index n, but now it's the array element index m. Also, we're now scanning over the angle theta and not through different discrete frequencies k. Remember that this new k number is the wave number and not the discrete frequency. One last change is that we'll call the output f of theta for the array factor as a function of scan angle. But that just gets us the contribution of the array from a single angle, theta. For example, here's the value at theta equals 0 radians. From here, like in the time series Fourier transform, where we can sweep across the frequency component to get the signal's performance at any frequency, we can sweep this theta to know how our array will perform at any angle in the range of negative pi to pi. But we already figured out the 1D array factor earlier in the video, so let's expand this to the second dimension as promised, because now that we have this fundamental equation, we can very easily expand it. So up to this point, we've been looking at a linear array of antennas spaced apart by dx, which allowed us to scan in theta. Now we can add antennas in the y dimension spaced apart by dy, which would allow us to scan in a new direction, phi. Let's call the theta scanning indices m, like we already have, and the new phi scanning indices n. Let's also change our generic w of m weights to be b sub m and c sub n. Or you could also use a 2D weighting matrix a sub m and n, which accounts for both. From here, we can just compute the array factor of these dimensions individually, then multiply the two, giving us a barely changed equation for the 2D array factor. Now, there are some assumptions made to get from here to here, but resource number one in the description has a good explanation of this. So there we go, let's plot it. Assuming a scan value is from negative pi to pi for both theta and phi, we can plug it in and compute the two-dimensional array factor, which actually gives you a three-dimensional output. And again, this will change depending on a number of factors, including the number of elements in both the x and y direction, the amplitude weights, b and c, the element spacings in both the x and y directions, and even more. Well, that was quite a lot, and there's so much more to cover. I'm really excited to share the next video about how the weights affect the pattern, otherwise known as beamforming. I really hope you enjoyed this and maybe even learned something. This was honestly a really difficult topic to explain concisely, so as with all my videos, I included a Python notebook where you can play around with these concepts yourself and produce some really cool looking plots. Also, as I was wrapping up this video, I realized that my friend, John Kraft, just uploaded a great video on phased arrays where he shows how this works with real hardware. That's another great resource in the description if you're learning about this stuff. Also in the description are resources, caveats, and all the source code for this video. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.